Only know.
Okay.
And to make a call.
Call the meeting to order.
7:05.
The, Judy, introduce Judy Moore for us. She is a Salisbury Lakeville resident, and she runs a very successful reuse program in Canaan. It's this and that for, or from Habitat. And do you know the people, Bill Brazel, he's the co-chair of building committee? Charlie, you know Charlie?
No.
You don't?
Charlie Kelly.
Charlie Kelly.
Well, now I do, thank you.
Yeah, co-chair. Well, it's from Salisbury.
No way.
Hi, Judy.
Hi, I'm Barbara.
Barbara.
Hi.
Hi, Patricia. Hi, no, Patricia, you're too.
Sim Lindgren, how are you?
Sheriff. These are all trying to deliver Sim.
Okay.
And so, what, why don't you explain your program and then?
Okay. Well, this and that from Habitat is a resale store that we've been running for 8.5 years now in Canaan. We've expanded considerably. We were in a small building at Gear for 5.5 years. And 3 years ago, as of July 1st, we moved to our current location, which is across the street from Decker and Beatty on Route 7. We went from a building that was 400 square feet to one that was over 4,000 square feet. And then 2 years ago, we took over the barn in back, which was another 4,000 square feet. And on Mother's Day, we took over the building next door, which is, I don't know how many square feet.
It's Canaan.
Well, and, you know, so we have that whole little complex now. And the newest building, where Scavellini used to be, is an experiment. We're going to decide on the 18th if we're going to stay there or not. I kind of have to prove its worth to make sure that we stay there. But about now, I feel like if they don't want to stay, they can move everything back out of it. Because I get a little tired moving things. But we're doing very well. The move from Gear to our current location was amazingly successful. Our numbers just went through the roof. I have a goal, a personal goal for doing this. I've been doing it for 8.5 years. And my goal is to be able to underwrite the cost of a house within a 12-month period.
Do you rent all those buildings? You rent, okay.
Our landlord's very good to us, though. And I had it figured out, and I thought I was going to be able to do it, but this winter was a little bit tricky. The weather didn't cooperate, so I didn't earn the income I was hoping for from January to June. But I was close. And I figured out, because I have to let them know in July if this new piece of our venture is a good one, I was just curious how much money we'd taken in the last 8.5 years. So I went back. And it's not net, it's our gross, but it doesn't account for sales tax, because to me, that's a wash, you know, that's in and out. I don't see that money. And in the last 8.5 years, as of last day of June, the store has made over $448,000. We're taking in over $448,000, because we have utilities and rent and stuff like that. So it's a very worthwhile experience. It's our ongoing fundraiser to raise money to build houses, buy land, what have you. And it's one of the ways that we can help the community.
Does all your proceeds go to the Habitat? Is that how that?
Everybody who works is a volunteer. Yeah, so once we've paid our.
Is that a local organization there?
Habitat for Humanity, Northwest Connecticut.
Northwest Connecticut.
We do Canaan, Falls Village, Salisbury, Sharon, Cornwall, and Norfolk. Slightly different from the region. We don't include Kent, because Kent was originally part of the New Milford affiliate, which unfortunately closed, so we had Norfolk. But yeah, Sharon is part of it. We're still trying to find a place in Sharon. It's our last town that we haven't had a building in yet. So anyway, that's this and that for Habitat. It's all donation, as far as the things that we sell. We don't really do clothes or books, which makes us different from the bargain barn, which they do. I mean, I have a couple pieces, articles of clothing and a few books, but there's plenty of venues for books between all the library sales and things like that. And I mean, my store could be nothing but clothing and books, and that's not what we are. So we do tchotchkes, we do linens, we do toys on a small basis. We do furniture, we do china, we do building materials, bicycles, appliances, sporting goods, vinyl, as John would say, records. But that's what we make our money on.
When you said you're looking for a building in Sharon, and those other towns,
yeah.
Is there a place where people drop things off? Is that what you mean? Or?
No, I meant we were looking for a spot to build.
Oh, yeah, house. Build a house. Okay.
Yeah, we want to be represented in all of the towns. Okay. We don't want people to think that we're
avoiding. Can you subdivide your property?
Can you
That's what, Ellsworth, not Ellsworth.
He's in Ellsworth.
In Ellsworth, though. I'll take it. A guy who used to be the head of the Lakeville Journal, his sister.
Yeah.
Gave us a chunk of the land, cut off 2 acres, and gave us a chunk up on Selig Hill. Most of the land. Yeah, up on Selig Hill.
Yeah.
That was our fourth house.
Do you take everything that people bring in?
No, everything. No, they wouldn't. The transfer station wouldn't need me if I took everything.
I mean, but I suppose people come to the sale.
Oh, they come. Yeah, they come.
And do you say, "I'm sorry, we don't want that"?
If it's clothing and books, you better believe it.
Okay.
I tell them I don't want that. We have a donation policy that's posted. I don't like people to drop things off when I'm not there, because when we were in our small location, somebody dropped me off a beautiful leather couch. At least I think it was beautiful. Before I found it, it was rained on and ruined. I had to take a chainsaw to it and haul it off to the dump, because nobody told me it was there. It was in the back of the building. I arrived there the other morning, and there were 2 straddle sewing machines, a hutch, a dresser, and something else that somebody had left. It, you know, the weather today, for example, you know, if you don't know something's coming, and this time of year we're open 7 days a week, from 10 until 4, until middle of October, then from mid-October to mid-May, we go back to just Fridays, Saturdays, and Sundays, because once the summer people and the leaf peepers go away, our weekday traffic really comes to a screeching halt because all the locals are working. In the summer, I have my vacationers who are wonderful.
And teachers.
And teachers, that too.
Yeah.
Do you price everything yourself?
That's what I want to ask.
Yeah, I do. Oh, yeah. And I know where most everything is, so when somebody says, "Do you have a fill in the blank?" I can usually direct them to it. Unless somebody has picked it up, changed their mind, and moved it to a place it doesn't belong.
And do you have a range of customers, or could you generalize about your, you know, just...
No, I have dealers that come in and buy from me. I have dealers that come in and donate from
because
me. Sometimes
your goal
the same dealers.
It's not necessarily to redirect it to people I need. It's to raise money to build a house.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
To build houses for those who cannot otherwise qualify for a transitional mortgage.
Right. So more people in need in another way.
Yeah. And in fact, we had family selection today to look for new homeowners. So...
However, the prices are reasonable enough to where a lot of low-income people come and shop there.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah, they are.
How do you, pricing, how do you have, what percentage off of retail, let's say, retail being an arbitrary?
Yeah, well, it depends. I was a tag seller for many years, so I kind of go by that. You know, if it's an antique, obviously it's going to go for more money than if it's set of glasses. I mean, I sold a set of nice glasses, 11 glasses the other day for $5 to two women who were going to split them. Whatever.
I bought a bathroom scale for $8.
There you go. And you know, I'm pretty good about trying to, if it's an electrical appliance or a battery-driven appliance, to try it to make sure it works. I don't want to put something out that somebody's going to take home and say, "Well, this isn't working. You have to return it." It's not fair to them. It's not fair to us. I'd rather take the time up front to see if it works, then inconvenience them and inconvenience us.
I would think college kids would show.
Oh, college kids for sure.
Little dressers, little things.
I had a gal come in the other day who was setting up an apartment up at Hoosick, New York. She bought 2 dressers and a beautiful set of dishes with dad in tow. Who I think paid for it.
Isn't that great?
But we have a lot of kids that set up first apartments through us.
How often do you, so you come into our transfer station, go on our swap shop and look?
Oh yeah, I just live right around the corner.
Do you go to all the other towns? Is that, are you there
I don't. One of my volunteers lives in Canaan, so she handles that.
All right.
One of my volunteers, or one of my former board members and has been a volunteer, has a house both in Canaan and Lakeville, so he hits both of them. Don't really do Falls Village. One of them does Sheffield for me, so yeah.
So you're here once a week, kind of?
Oh, no, daily.
Daily, oh.
Sometimes three times a day, it depends. But this time of year, I'm working at the store every day, so, you know, if I'm out and about on a given day, I'll get up in the morning and I'll go, and if I'm out at lunchtime, I'm swinging home, like I say, I'm right around the corner. I'll drop in at the end of the day. Because things change, and I'm very helpful in helping to empty out, I think. I help on that end. And the money, like I said, we're all volunteers, the money goes to Habitat. The only time it goes in my pocket is when I'm bringing it home to put in the bank.
When you go through our swap shop, when you peruse what's there, what do you, out of all that's there?
What do I pick?
No, out of all that's there, what do you think percentage-wise is worth?
Taking?
Taking.
How much is junk?
How much is junk? Yeah, that's how to say it.
Okay, well, again, we don't take everything. So there's a lot of things that I know I can't sell, we don't sell, so I just don't even look at it. So clothes are not something I take. Books, unless it's for me, are not something I take. But if there's a nice coffee table book, I will take that. I found a great book for one of the teachers on film noir, he was thrilled with it. I found another one for a social studies teacher, it was the first edition of something, and he was over the moon about me having brought it to him. So, you know, I think about my friends, my former colleagues too, when I look at the books, but I don't bring them back to the store for the most part. Small appliances, small electrical appliances, if they're working, I'll take them home and try them. Glassware sometimes, games, children's games, you know, board games.
What do you think?
There was a neat elliptical exercise machine that I picked up the other day. I haven't tried it out yet, but that'll go into our sporting goods section. Oh, that's something else we sell, sporting goods. I just haven't had the time or the energy to try it at this point. What else? Oh, sleighs, old sleighs, you know, in the winter. Trying to think, what else have I brought up? Furniture, small furniture. I drive a Honda, so it can't be very big. Although I've lucked out because occasionally when there's been a bigger piece of furniture, somebody I know with a pickup truck has been there, at least brought it back to my house. And then I'll call my husband into bringing it up to me. But with his truck. He keeps telling me I need to get a bigger car. What else do I take? I don't know.
But do you see a lot
of variety?
Do you see a lot of junk in our swap shop or not? Of course you'd be a true
I'm a
judge of junk.
Yeah, oh yes, with a QUE. I see things that puzzle me because and maybe I'm not up to date on the rules. You know, sometimes people will put TVs and video monitors in there. And I keep thinking they're supposed to go over to the trailer.
They are.
Clothes. Sometimes the clothes that are in there that I always thought clothes were supposed to go to bins are, and I may be misinformed on it, but somebody once told me the clothes that go into those bins get shredded and used in various and sundry ways. They aren't resold like in Goodwill or Salvation Army. I don't know.
Aren't they sorted by?
They first get sorted.
They do.
By usable.
So
they're worth more money as usable clothing than they are as rags.
I thought so, yeah. And so some people bring the clothes into the swap shop as opposed to putting them in the bins. Sometimes I wonder why. It should be shredded.
Yeah, if it's good clothing, it's certainly welcome in the swap shop. If it's not, put it in the bin.
Yeah, exactly.
Even from the bin, I sort everything.
Yes.
Yeah, right.
It's not their responsibility to do it.
But there are a lot of broken.
Not your responsibility.
There seem to be a lot of, not quite working things.
Yeah, and that sometimes happens. Mm-hmm. But like I said, I don't take the time there because I'm usually on my way to the store to try it. I'll take it home and try it in the store. If it doesn't, what did I have the other day? Something, I can't remember. It was predominantly metal and it didn't work. So I said, it'll go in the metal bin. They'll make some money on it in the metal
bin. Well, one of the things we were just discussing in the last meeting was we can't watch that, it's hard for the staff to watch that very closely. Things in there, end up in there that shouldn't be in there. And then it takes a lot of time and effort and energy and cost to get them sorted and thrown away.
Oh, definitely. Well, I've noticed in the last week or so, I think I mentioned to you that the cleanup, since I'm here every morning, I know the merchandise pretty well. And it seems to be being cleaned out on a almost daily basis now, and it was being cleaned out today when I got there. I was very sad.
And today we had to close it.
Yeah.
Because people kept coming in. You could not get around the people as you're trying to close it. And somebody came in from a tag sale and said, oh, well, people got a lot of free stuff at the end. It was all free. Well, you're bringing me the stuff that nobody wanted for free. Why do you think they're going to want it for free in the swap shop?
And when we,
you know, it's, you've got three glasses. Okay, that's really helpful to somebody.
Yeah, exactly. Unless it matches your set. I mean, I've said to Brian, because he's been very good to us, I also run the big Habitat tag sale in Hodgepodge in August every year, August 8, 9, 10, when you're interested. And always have to put out a plug. And we don't bring, we buy a dumpster. We get a dumpster for the stuff that we don't want. The only arrangements I've ever made with them is to bring any metal, which we separate out and put in the metal bin, and cardboard boxes, which we collapse down and put in the cardboard recycling. But we do not bring our tag sale leftovers. I've been there after church tag sales or somebody else's, and you have to wade through the stuff, and it's the stuff that doesn't sell. And like you say, who would want it? If somebody didn't want it at the tag sale, if somebody didn't want it for free at the end, why would they want it for free in the transfer station? The only time we did ever bring leftover stuff, which was before we started getting the dumpster, was when the, was it a Goodwill van? Was that before you, Brian?
Before me.
Okay, there was a Goodwill trailer that was up by the gate. And they took things, and we had spoken with the guy from Goodwill. And he said, if I'm not here, just put it under the trailer so it's out of the weather, which we did. I only remember doing that once, though, or maybe twice when he was there. But that's the only time we bring our leftovers to the transfer station, because it's not fair to them, and it's not fair to the people who frequent it, I don't think.
Of the percentage of material that comes in to your, do you call it a store, or what do you call it? Sorry, okay. What percentage is unusable in the alley?
You mean what people bring us?
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah, some of it, because we currently have a dumpster sitting right alongside the barn. Mm-hmm. We were given a mattress and box spring. I said, oh God, that went in. Somebody left us a couch, love seat, when nobody was there. Some cat had attacked it, you know, as a scratching post. That went in there. I mean, stuff like that. I'm not going to try to peddle stuff or have it take up the space that I can't. I don't have the space to do that. We had a dumpster there from January till June that we were working on filling up. That's gone. The new dumpster we brought in June is now full.
That's a 30-yard roll.
It's a, you saw it.
Yeah.
You were there.
30-yard, I think. That's not very much.
And, you know, we are not trying to be garbage man to the world, you know. And I tell people when they bring us things or they call about donations, the stuff has to be clean, in good working condition, and sellable. I mean, my hands split every winter from washing stuff that isn't clean. I'm not going to put it out if it isn't. I refuse.
So the dumpster you just got in was put in beginning of
June?
Beginning of June.
So that's pretty fast.
Do you,
the first one was only from
Well, over the winter, January. You don't get as much, you know.
But a 30-yard dumpster is, if you threw out all the stuff in our swap shop, if you kept track, how long would it take us to fill a 30-yard dumpster?
Not very long. Well, but are you throwing it all in as
bulky? No, the unusable.
The unusable stuff.
The stuff that you hoe out, so to speak.
Just this morning, you know, where you used to put your bottles and cans in, the bigger one?
Yep.
That was full of garbage. So that doesn't include the cardboard or the metal or the wooden pieces that went in the glove box.
5 or 6 yard. So that's in one day.
Oh, but at least you can bring that on the tractor over, right?
Mm-hmm.
So that probably helps a little bit just to have that. Yeah.
But still, hers was a month.
That fills up fast.
We would fill it in 1 week, five, sixes, or 30.
Right, but that's what we were talking about at the previous meeting.
Yeah.
They are attended.
Yes.
And they're able to keep track of what's coming in the door.
But you, do you turn stuff away or do you take it home?
I turn stuff away.
Okay.
Because, well, like I said, people will bring us things that we don't take, and I'm saying, I'm sorry, we don't take that. We were trying to restrict our donation days to Fridays and Saturdays, well, so much for that.
But it sounds like people are bringing and leaving when it is unattended.
Yes.
So, and that's probably, it's, if it's simpler to take it there than to haul it all the way to the.
Well, for example, we start setting up for our big tag sale on August, July 26th. So I have a big poster in the store right now that went up. No donations at the store from July 26th to April, I think I said 15, August 15th, excuse me. If you have anything, bring it to Hotchkiss. Because I can't come back to 3 weeks worth of stuff after I've just done this tag sale. I started that last year. Now, last year, when one of my volunteers was there working, and he told this gentleman that, I think the guy had come down from Barrington or someplace over the line, he said, I'm sorry, you're gonna have to take it to Hotchkiss, we can't accept anything. That was on a Saturday. When they came back to work Sunday morning, the stuff was all there. Guy waited till he closed and left it. Came back and left it.
But of the.
Because he wasn't gonna take it.
No. Of the stuff, yeah, that's what we have the same thing. It's they're there on a Sunday. It's metal and bulky waste right now. They're there, our residents are there on a Sunday. And what are they gonna do with it? So what I find someone will do it is they'll go over by the tire bin, and they'll stick it between, or they stick it around the corner, because they have no, you know, they need to get rid of it.
And these people all have received the information that says, because they have a sticker, that says you don't accept this on Sundays.
Doesn't matter, they need to get rid of it then.
Never plan ahead.
But of the material you, that you do take, do you take it all, or do you call as they bring it in?
As they bring it, we take it. We just, yeah, and there are times when it's so busy, I can't. We have a storage area on the side of our barn, where I was working the day you stopped by, and Judy Becker and I were working, and that's all tag sale stuff. That's all gonna be going to Hotchkiss. And sometimes when I'm there by myself, you don't have time to go through everything, so it just gets put there for future review. Well.
So they bring it in.
If I have time, I go through it and say, okay, this is store, this is tag sale. And then I start making boxes of tag sale stuff.
But the stuff that gets thrown away, do you turn it back to them?
No, because they leave.
Okay. So that's the same we get on our transfer, in our swap shop. They come in, they leave it. And you're stuck with it, we're stuck with it.
The thing is, when we're fully not attended, the gate is closed. When you're not there.
Right.
So it really comes out.
It's a little different.
It's a little different, but you get bigger things left.
Yeah, I mean, and I've had some people who've been moving, and I'm turning into the shrew of the store, I think, because I say, if you bring me stuff, it has to be in a box with a lid that I can stack, because I have to be able to stack things, and I don't always have time to go through the boxes. And some of them who have been bringing me stuff lately have gotten it. And I'll come and I'll find a stack of boxes with lids, taped, and it's like, okay, and at least they're right outside where you saw us. So, okay, fine, I can move them in, I can stack them, and we'll go through this tag sale. I don't know what's in them, but.
How many volunteers, how many staff do you usually have?
At the store?
Yeah.
On Mondays, it's, there. This time of year, I'm there every day. On Mondays, it's Peg. On Tuesdays, it's Samantha. On Wednesdays, it's Chris. On Thursdays, it's Barbara. On Fridays, it's John. On Saturdays, it's John and myself. And on Sundays, it's me. Judy Becker has been an enormous help, and she's been coming over. Like she told me today, she'd be there Friday and Saturday. She's not supposed to be there, but she's just really jumped in. And
so you're staffed, though?
One person, and so usually, technically one.
Usually one, you plus one.
I'm always there.
You plus one.
Yeah. So my only day, real day, is Friday. Excuse me, is Saturday and Sunday. But, and the reason being, because people are bringing us stuff all the time. when my volunteer is there, whoever it happens to be, that person can take care of my customers and I can do work. I can go through boxes, I can clean stuff that needs to be cleaned. And with the three buildings, you know, I'm floating too, from building to building.
Do you barter to customers back offers, do you take them or?
Depends. Depends on how long I've had the item.
And if something's there for a long, long time, it doesn't sell, you just?
Well, we, for the month of May, we had a May Madness sale, everything was 50% off.
Oh, okay.
For the entire month. Even the stuff in our new building, which only opened on Mother's Day. It was a successful month, we took in $18,000. Which, you know, it's a lot, and when you figure it's all secondhand merchandise, it's great.
How much material do you go out and collect? Or pick up from people, the oversized or the?
That's John.
Is there a lot of that?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, and we, it ranges, I mean, it could be Alfred. He could go up to Alfred, Mass to get stuff. Great Barrington, Sheffield, Monterey, the six towns we cover. There are certain things we can't keep in stock. We cannot keep washing machines and refrigerators in stock. We are constantly getting calls. Stoves go out on a pretty regular basis, although it always seems that when people are looking for electric, we have propane, and when people are looking for propane, we have electric. So dishwashers, we have a bunch of dishwashers right now. Air conditioners. No, I'm not bartering on air conditioners. I had a gentleman a couple weeks ago say, will you take less for the air conditioner? I said, now? Talk to me in November. Not now, no. And he paid the asking price for it. I just got in a brand new air conditioner, still in the box, from some weekenders who were cleaning out their store.
How much are you asking?
Yeah.
$100. It's a nice one. It's $5,000. We're open 10 to 4, 7 days a week. If you want.
Open tomorrow morning at 10.
I'll be there.
How often do dealers come by?
Oh, I have one guy who's there weekly, both bringing me stuff and buying stuff. I have another guy who comes at least once a month. Usually he's buying, but he brings me stuff.
What do they bring? Things that aren't selling in their?
Yeah, things, and I can sell them, because I can ask less than they do. And the guy who comes weekly.
But they're giving them to you, so.
The guy who comes weekly is in a, antiques consortium up in Barrington, and he's told other dealers about me, so I know there's at least three others that he's brought to me who both buy and sell. And I had to laugh because he brought me, what did he bring me? Piece of furniture, Canterbury. It was May, it was because it was in the new building, so it was like Mother's Day, or right around Mother's Day. A day or two later, one of the people that's in his consortium bought it. Worked for me. Worked for Habitat. I mean, it was great. I had to giggle. I had to tell him next time he came in, which was really funny.
Judy, you said you were in the swap shop often.
Oh yeah.
Do you leave empty-handed often?
No.
Or?
No.
So you are
seldom. I did today.
You are finding some treasures.
Oh yeah.
Go, for the most part.
Yeah. And you just never know. I mean, jewelry. We sell jewelry at the store. I find jewelry, costume jewelry. I found some sterling there a few weeks ago that didn't go to the store.
Yeah, you're a resident.
That's my pay. I'm a resident.
So your overhead is rent, electricity, and heat.
And phone. Telephone. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's what it is. Mm-hmm. I haven't calculated out our net for January to June, the end of June this year, but our net from July 1 to the last day of December last year, our net was $55,000 at the store. So I was hoping for 50 in the first half of this year, but if we had winters like we had last 2 years, it would be better. So I'm down from what I was hoping for. And at the tax sale last year, we netted $32,000, and that was down a little bit too. We've been netting about 35. And that's, Hotchkiss is very good to us over there. They've been, this will be our 12th year there, our 24th.
That's inside of the gym or something?
In the field house, that's
right.
Down by the pool and the skating rinks. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So for all the 8.5 years you've been there, you've come and combed through
all lots of stuff.
Okay. Do you think that affects, I mean, I still find a few treasures there. I guess I just have to avoid the times that you're going.
But I think about it, my mother, if she were still alive, would be just laughing at me because she couldn't get me to go to a tag sale. Why would I want to plow through other people's things? And then she took me to one of Artie Shaw's house over on Lakeville Lake, and that was it. It was all over after that. I became a tag sale junkie, and then if she could see this, she just wouldn't believe it. Because we started this after she passed away. She would think it was very funny, I know. Very funny. Oh, well.
But it's a great service.
It's for a good cause.
Recyclables.
And we do have pictures in the store of the houses we built in the area. So people, that was my cousin's suggestion when we opened the store years ago. So people can see where the money is going. And, you know, they'll be like, oh, I know where that house is, and I know where that house is. And it's kind of nice. And, you know, we get volunteers. I mean, I have people coming into the store who volunteer. Chris, my Wednesday guy, came in last year and wanted to volunteer. Barbara Belmonte is my Thursday person. I've known her from subbing. You know, she subbed at the high school. She's my Thursday person. The gal who does Mondays used to run the Little Guild thrift shop in West Cornwall. So she knows what she's doing. My Tuesday person is the daughter of one of my board members. John Pogue is Friday, so you know, Mr. Habitat. And I do weekends. So it's good. And our tag sale, I have, it varies from year to year, anywhere from 50 to 75 volunteers that work that. Inside, it's mostly women. The guys do the hauling for us. And it's
great.
An addiction, I guess.
It's great.
It's a good addiction.
You pay for the disposal in the dumpster also. Is that an expense?
Yeah, you pay for the dumpster. The dumpster that we have at the tag sale is $600. And it's a bigger one than the one we have at the store. I think that's $480,
okay.
I think.
Do you pay for that?
Yeah, I
know. I'll have to talk to Scott at Welsh.
It would be nice. Welsh does our stuff over in Pine Grove, so in fact, I just got a bill from them for a monthly pickup in Pine Grove.
And do you provide, people come in, do you provide them a donation certificate?
Yes. And it is the responsibility of the donor to set the value of the goods that have been donated. And I always tell them, you don't turn it in with your taxes, you put it with the your copy that you keep. If you get audited, you have to be able to produce it.
Right.
That's how that works. We've been doing that forever. Tag sales, and long before we had the store. But the store was really an offshoot of the tag sale. We were offered the space a year for storage, because we were always looking for storage. And when I saw it, I said, oh, storage, store. Had a big picture window, and it was a small space, and it was an experiment, see if it would fly. We didn't know. They gave it to us for the first year for space, and then started charging us minimal rent. But, you know, it fills a void, it fills a need, I think, in the community. I have customers that come from everywhere. I mean, they come from over in Copaig, they come from Millerton, they come from the six towns that we cover, they come from Monterey, they come from Barrington. They come from Alfred. They come from Sheffield and Ashley Falls, of course. They come from Winstead. One lady was there from Walcott the other day. I'm always getting new customers. A woman was in today. We've never been. She lives in Great Barrington. She just never comes to Canaan. She goes the other way. We are not a restore. A restore is different from what we are. A restore is primarily building materials. We're basically a thrift store, a resale shop, whatever you'd like to call us. Yes, we have some building materials, but that's not our primary focus. You had to jump through a lot of hoops to become a restore, and at the time we weren't. It was the size of your affiliate, the number of houses you build in a year, do you have an executive director, a lot of stuff that Habitat National required. And we didn't meet those requirements. And I didn't know I had to have permission to open the store to begin with, but after 5 years, they weren't going to tell us we had to close it, so. They didn't. They said, like, you've been doing it, so. And I, you know, I knew people. I give my 30-second song and dance about volunteers. It's all volunteers and you know, who we are and the whole thing. So people know. We were very fortunate. We're working on a house in Canaan currently, up on New High Street in the Green Acres section that we bought that went into foreclosure. And the Connecticut Geothermal Association found us I don't know, online or whatever. And they are giving us a geothermal heating and cooling system, and all they want is publicity. That's a $30,000 or $40,000 gift.
And their name is for the camera?
Connecticut Geothermal Association. There's 13 different contractors working on it. Different guys are putting in a different piece of it. The guy who dug the well, it was, oh, on a bitter cold day in December, was the Connecticut Valley artisan well drillers out of Long Meadow, Mass. And he was down and he did that, and we had dinner with the guys, it was great. We also have an electrician out of, and I hate to say this, it's one of the Berries, it's Middlebury or Southbury or Woodbury, I can't remember where it is. His name is Brian Nettleton. He found us 8 or 10 years ago and does a house a year for us, materials and labor.
Wow.
And he's been doing that.
That's a hell of a donation.
It is, and he has to travel to come up and do this for us. Wonderful man. And the Geothermal Association, they're great. We've had a lot of work to do, and the guys from the Beckley House in Canaan do volunteer work in the community on the weekends. They've helped us out a lot. I can't say enough good about them. They've just been amazing. They helped us move into our new space. What they're able to do in the space of 3 hours boggles my mind. We've been very fortunate. Never mind our own board members and people who work on the tag sale, our wine tastings that we have biannually. This year we did an art show. Next year is the wine tasting year again. I mean, we have different venues and lots of good people. Lots of good people that work with us. We're very fortunate. But this is our daily fundraiser, the store. And that's why I pillage the transfer station. So we're, stuff is going to a good cause, and it's the money staying local, so. Mm-hmm.
And I don't know how many years ago, maybe 5 years ago, Track wrestled with the question of, should we let people take it out and take it to Torrington or resell it or wherever, sell it, Craigslist. And Track did make a decision that no matter where it went, it did not matter. It was staying out of the hopper. And so what you're doing is completely in line with the recommendation that Track, we want this reused, and we recognize that Salisbury and Sharon can't reuse all the material that comes in there. And it doesn't hurt to let it go, to someone that can. And usually the other part of it was that the people coming in and picking from the transfer station, and even if they took it and sold on Craigslist, they were probably in need of a little extra financial help. And maybe they didn't use it themselves, but it provided some financial help. So Track made the decision and the recommendation that it was okay, just that you didn't reuse it directly. I'm glad you're taking advantage of that.
And the Bargain Barn, I know, also helps with those things. But it's an education. And there are a lot of nice people there. Catch you cross paths with too.
That's right.
What? How could we improve our swap? Or can it be improved? Maybe it's perfect.
Well, it's difficult because you're looking at cost, really. I think. I don't know how much time you guys spend in there unless they're clearing it out.
They do a lot of organizing, don't they?
I don't know how much organizing.
They don't.
There are some people who come in to shop
and end up
who organize.
That's
the books. One of my friends goes in and she'll organize the books. She'll be wandering around and she'll say, "Oh, well, and she'll come and do that." If you had a way to screen the stuff that came in, so garbage that sometimes winds up in there. I mean, I get the same thing at the store. I sometimes wonder why people bring me some things, and I think, well, are you, do you just not want to take it to your own transfer station, or what's the deal? I mean, I like, you have the lending library. I think that's great. Being a former teacher,
I get so much stuff.
I hate to see books get trashed. But I realize it gets to a point, I mean, you know, okay, fine, we don't need the 1952 Encyclopedia Britannica there. You know, I mean, that is a different story. Like I said, I picked up some good books for other people. The kids section, I don't know, maybe it would help, I don't know, if people would read and follow the rules of the band.
That would be a good call.
I sometimes feel our schools are not doing a good job when I deal with the help with the store. You know, and there are sections. There's the library. There's a kids section. There's the oil and the recycled oil and stuff down on the end. The other side is pretty wide open as far as what goes there. You know, kid stuff belongs in the kids section, and that's what it should be. And for the most part, that's what you get.
I think so, yeah.
But some people choose to put other things over there. And it's not because the other side is full. It's because maybe they've got some kids' things, so they leave everything there. Or books wind up on the opposite side or down by Kidland. You know, that kind of thing. The batteries are always up, and the eyeglasses are always up at the by the door by the office, you know, and that's fine. And there are certain areas for certain things. There's the bin for the light bulbs. Funny things. You know, there's the bin for that. I think, I don't know, are people pretty good? I know if I drop something, I know where the broom is, so I go and get it and clean up the mess and throw it away. I think your regulars are pretty respectful of it.
It's the boxes of stuff, where there are broken things inside the box, you know, there's a couple of good things in there, but something shifted and broken, or there's, you know.
They just bring the whole box.
And if it's glass.
It's mostly good except for where the rats got in and.
Yeah, and they're cleaning out their barn or their basement or whatever, and it's like, oh. And I know you always have a rule about not leaving stuff outside the swap shop, you know. And yet you'll see things there. And I don't know if that's because people have arrived after 10 or 4 with a piece of furniture and the swap shop is closed. And so, well, just like on Sunday, they're there, so there it goes. You know, people bring broken pieces of furniture. I don't know if they think it's worth salvaging if somebody wants to put the time in, or if they don't want to pay the fee to put it in the demo box. I don't know, because I don't know, you know, why they do that. Exercise equipment, oh, don't take any of that. We can't sell it. You know, everybody's full of good intentions. I know we have a couple pieces at our own house that are gathering dust.
Well, exercise equipment has about 3 minutes on it, and then it ends up there. So this isn't as much fun as I was going to be.
Yeah, well, I saw one of the gazelles there this morning, you know. And I thought, oh, didn't like that one either. And that stuff is there, and I don't think it lasts. The Nordic tracks. Nordic tracks up the wazoo. You don't see them quite so much anymore, but used to see them a lot.
Metal box.
Every Nordic track I've ever seen after a month ends up as a closed rack.
We used to get them at the tag sale, and God bless Janice Fitch. She took a lot of it because she was setting up an exercise room at the school, so we supplied her with an awful lot until she finally said, Uncle, I can't take it.
Do we have signs? I mean, I can't remember because I just go in and I know exactly where to go, but there are signs that say kids, aren't there?
There sure are.
There is a sign that says kids stuff?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So well, if you ever need, I have a laminator at work and I go in somewhere. So if you ever want me to redo some signs, just let me know. Oh, you have a laminator? Okay.
But I mean, there's only so much organization you can do.
There's no room.
There isn't.
I think that's
there is. You have the shelf, which is great, and then you have the second one down has the second shelf.
Yeah,
I know well what you have there, and then over in Kidland there's the second shelf. The main one doesn't have a shelf underneath it. You have the bookcases for the books, which is great. Like I said, the Encyclopedia Britannicas didn't come in and take up stuff. You know, and then people will have had book sales or whatever, and then there's cartons of books that they bring without discriminating. And that's sometimes where the encyclopedias are. And it's like, you know, they should just go into the paper hopper. Who wants a 1952 encyclopedia?
Well, some hardcover books can't go
or the textbooks.
It doesn't matter.
Or textbooks, all textbooks, yeah.
Yeah.
Again, I get it, so make them booked in.
I mean, who wants a 1960s or 1870s textbook?
What we're leaning towards is a bigger one with overhead doors, easier way to get a machine in there and clean it out. And then maybe if we could try to think about some kind of volunteers to kind of keep an eye on it, or someone to keep an eye on it. So, do you think those three things are good ideas? I mean, that we think they might be helpful.
Yeah. I enjoy going over there. I think it's fun. I think it's a lot for the guys to handle as far as cleaning it out. I don't know if having been cleaning it out more on a daily basis has helped or not, although after this weekend, apparently you really got hammered. You gonna be open tomorrow morning? Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you.
Yes,
just checking.
But if I got the numbers right from you, you've got over 8,000 square feet of space.
Yeah.
You had 8,000, now you have more. Which is 20 times what we have.
Yeah, at least 10. And I mean, when we have the stuff set up in my main building, I have aisles kind of the way Johnson's
right.
has in Millerton.
Right.
In the barn, which is now going to become primarily building materials, right down the center is our appliances in you know, two rows back to that. Sporting goods is there. Windows and doors are in bins on the left. Bathroom vanities are in the back corner. Beds are over here. They grow. They multiply. Oh, you know, a lot of headboards and footboards and side rails. John's vinyl is over here, along with a whole lot of tile. One of my former students who has a tile business was getting rid of these humongous cartons of tile, beautiful marble tiles. And I said, oh, because I usually ask if somebody's there when I pick up the stuff, would you mind if I took it for Habitat? Oh no, and they loaded it right in my car. Well, I didn't realize how heavy it was.
Yeah.
I could get out the little ones, but the big things of the big marble tiles, they're like 16-inch squares, and there were like maybe 10 or 12 of them in a styrofoam. I couldn't lift the things. I had to wait till some of the guys came to get them out of my car. But I could do the smaller ones. And then this was in the winter where he had them. And he says, oh, I've got more. I'll just bring them up to the store. There were 7 or 8 of these big styrofoam containers that he left outside. And then we got snow. But that, you know. But I mean, we made good money to build houses with that stuff. Mm-hmm. And we used some of it in the houses we built.
Could use it.
Yeah, oh yeah. And if there's stuff that we could use, we do. Mm-hmm. Lighting fixtures, or that's another thing, we have lighting fixtures. We have a lighting center now. I don't know if you see a difference in drop-offs by season.
Sure.
Like, do you get more in the summer because the weekenders
yes.
are here?
Yes.
Than in the winter when it's the local people. I just happen to think of that now, and I assumed that was the way it was.
Well, just the whole volume of the station goes up in the summer.
Mm-hmm. Which makes sense. The population is up,
mm-hmm.
and people
yeah.
are cleaning
yeah.
out.
So, but yeah. people, yeah, people are cleaning things out more.
Mm-hmm.
You know, in the wintertime, nobody's going to pull something out of the basement usually.
Right. I had a meeting Saturday morning, so I didn't get to the store until 2 in the afternoon. I had somebody covering for me. I couldn't believe the quantity of stuff that had come in that morning. I was like, it was boxes, it was furniture, it was all kinds of stuff. And it was sitting in front of our barn in the back. I was like, whoa. But yeah, so we have a lot of stuff, and you know, our stuff doesn't move out weekly either. I mean, we have a lot of space, and we have a lot of stuff. Our new building is set up more like a furniture store. We have vignettes of furniture around. So it isn't probably the most efficient use, but it's our better stuff. And so it's not all jammed in together.
It's kind of staged.
Yes, exactly. I've gotten a lot of compliments on it, which is great. It makes me feel
yeah.
good. And while, yeah, well, you were there.
Yeah.
And while John was laid up from having surgery, Judy Becker and I went and worked on the barn. And that's improved dress. And well, I hear this from my customers, my regulars who know, who've been in before and the after. And that's good. That's good that they're seeing the changes and they're acknowledging the changes. And they can see stuff now to buy it.
Mm-hmm.
So
brand new Whirlpool on top of their brand.
So
did it. What was that?
It was $100. Brand new.
$100.
So you know, we have, you know, the jet tubs. You know, we did good stuff. I have wonderful donors and I have wonderful customers. I can't say enough. They've been very good, they've been very supportive of Habitat, of the store. They're great, and a lot of the stuff I'm able to sell comes from here, and stays here.
What do you think the likelihood of us finding volunteers to help us?
I was wondering, well, that's why I was asking about your quantity of stuff. I don't know, I mean, like in Canaan, they have the job program in Canaan that...
And we have a Salisbury.
Salisbury, yeah, now, I don't know if in the summer you could get, you could get kids that could do that in the summer. I know there's a gal working there now, I don't know how old she is. She's just there, assuming for the summer, no hotel?
Yeah, 4 hours a day.
Okay.
I think for 5 weeks.
Okay.
20 hours a week.
All right, so I don't know if something like that, but if, depending on what the rules are, if somebody's trying to bring in something that's not acceptable, they're gonna roll over a kid.
Yeah, they are.
They're not gonna listen to the kid, which is sad, but that's the way it is.
But for that one, I mean, in a day, if a kid has to go ask someone once or twice a day about...
Yeah, and hopefully it's...
Acceptable, not, that's not as bad as just having to attend it all the time.
I'm just thinking, but it depends on, you know, how long the person would be there.
We're looking for year-round, the program will be running year-round, so...
Is it worth setting up feelers to see if there's anybody in the community? Some retired person who would want to take a day a week? Or do you have enough of them a day a month? You know, not every day.
No, no.
But that kind of thing, I mean, like my volunteers at the store do a day a week.
Well, that's where I was gonna bring that up. I think it would be possible to, you know, set up someone as a coordinator of volunteers and get a relatively good group of people, because, okay, we have a lot of people who are either retired or semi-retired. And it would give them something to do, and they don't get paid, but they could bring home some goodies.
Yeah, they'd be a first pick, they could lead me to the stuff, you know.
That's right.
It has to be somebody who's good with people.
Yeah.
Who's outgoing, who can deal with stress, because they may get put in a stressful situation by the people who bring things in, who don't want to hear about it. But it has to be somebody who's willing to do it and give you regular time. Like with my volunteers, you know, things come up and they can't be there on a given day, on their assigned day. So what I do is I gave them the phone numbers and contact information for everybody else. And
they find
before you come to me to tell me you can't do it, see if you can make a trade with somebody else for a different day. If it isn't gonna work, if you've tried everybody, I'll come in. Except not during the 2 weeks we're setting up for the tag sale. Because I'm already committed. I should be sometimes, but...
most of us should.
But, you know, they're very good about doing that. They don't have to go through me, I don't care. They're all doing the same job, it's just whatever day they happen to be in, it really does. You know, and they've been very good about it. We had it happen just last week, 2 weeks ago. And they traded off. And in fact, they didn't even trade off. There was a death in the family, and somebody just covered for this person and said, you know, he said, if you need me, whatever you need, I'll do it. So, but you have to get somebody like that, and if you're going to do a cadre of volunteers, you need to have people, and they need to be trained consistently so that people don't say, oh, well, on Monday, Bob let me do this, and today's Tuesday, and now you're telling me I can't do it. Well, maybe Bob didn't. And so if you're looking at that, you've got to make sure that people are all on the same page, I think, so they can't play one against the other or think they can do it because it's not what the person wanted to hear.
They would all still have to follow the rules.
Oh, yeah.
They're not employees.
For sure. For sure. And so that
the swap still falls under the transfer station.
I mean, you know, and like you need to know, and it isn't just Joe Smith. I mean, it's gotta be somebody who really.
As far as.
And they can organ, they can do the organization too. I mean, when stuff comes in, I don't know if they could be the.
They might be the one that throws it in the hopper.
Doesn't make the cut.
They would have to be.
And the stuff that does can go where it needs to be, Kidland or, you know, that kind of thing. And that would help to keep it neater.
There's, that raises another question. Liability insurance for the volunteers, if you ever.
Yeah, we have a release form that our volunteers sign.
Okay.
Because we get volunteers from the schools. We get volunteers from Hotchkiss, we get volunteers from Kent. We sometimes get volunteers from Berkshire, the guys from Beckley. And they all sign releases. Sometimes we just get the odd volunteer that comes. And like we have, and I don't know with volunteers if you have an age thing, because of the insurance, we can't have anyone under 16 working on the site because of hazardous stuff.
I know at HRA we had a form for volunteers on the workers' comp or something like that. I can't remember what it was.
We don't have work. That's a whole, are you an employee or not an employee, or yeah, you're a contractor, we just went through all our own people.
Yes.
I've got to run.
Okay.
Thanks for coming.
You're welcome.
Could you just hit that AC button?
Mm-hmm. The door will be.
I gotta lock the door, so no one can wander in. You can wander out.
Good. Thanks.
Great. Thank you. Very interesting.
Thank you. And come up and see us. If you're available.
Well, volunteer.
Excellent. Well, there's that too, but just to check out what we've got going, it will be great. 10 to 4, 7 days a week.
That's great.
Air conditioner, good air conditioner there.
Yeah.
Yeah, you need air conditioner.
I think it's taken already. I saw someone with a big smile over there.
Is there anything that you see that our swap shop and your program can do?
Well, I know you had mentioned something about Welsh and said something about being a repository.
Just giving it up and yeah.
Yeah, but that, because I don't take everything, because I don't sell everything, you know, it's, then what would happen to the stuff?
I don't think that's too viable. The building committee meeting, correct me if I'm wrong, Charlie, last meeting that preceded this, was there was sort of decision made that we weren't going to get rid of the swap shop and turn the program up. They turned it over to battered women, and that's they have a different business model than we do.
Well, Bob Lunks came up with the fact that if we in fact close the swap shop, they will set up a gallows.
It's fun, but it needs to be fun within.
Yeah.
Well, that's a whole different question than was addressed during the building committee meeting. If you're talking about subbing it out to another party, White River Junction, they have a whole other organization that basically rents for $1 a year space at that transfer station, and they run the swap area. So it's a rental, it's not part of the operations of the transfer station per se.
Mm-hmm.
It's a separate,
mm-hmm,
you know, it's a separate party that runs it. And it is located at the transfer station inside the building, next to their educational building. But it's completely separate.
The only problem I see with that, for our purposes, for Habitat, is that, like I said, we don't take everything. And then we would have to cart it, not that I don't do enough carting, John doesn't, but we would have to then take it up to Canaan. And I don't know how viable that is. I mean, John is out picking up stuff all over. I mean, I don't schedule him because I couldn't. There's no way for pickups. I always tell people to call John directly.
Question and follow up on that. That organization, do they sell the material?
I believe they do.
Okay. I think track.
No, session. I understand. Track wanted it for free, but the building committee is concerned about money to try to justify having it. I think the residents want to have it. You know, it's
a service.
It goes round and round.
It does.
You know,
yes.
At a certain point, people need to decide what they want to have and what they want to spend.
Yes.
And, you know, you can be economically efficient in your little tiny three-cylinder car, but you can't pull a giant trailer with it. So, you know, you have a pickup truck, it's not as efficient, but doing what you need to do sometimes requires something.
Yeah, and I think that's, the sense of the meeting was that swap shop is here, they centralize these operations. The sense of the meeting was that we're gonna put capital money into where this current swap shop was built for grant and exists. So we have repairs and maintenance, which are minimal. But as far as a facility, we're gonna have to put capital dollars into it. And then, you know, there's talk of doubling the size, let's say, or 2.5 times the size. So then you have those capital dollars, and then once you get there, once you have the big truck that can buy the big trailer, you've got to hire a different class driver and pay a lot more than the driver that can drive the little car. And that's one of the concerns was, like you say, what size car do we need at what cost? Because we're gonna buy the car to begin with now.
Well, I understand, but we went from the last meeting with the haulers to we're getting rid of the swap shop to tonight that, you know, it's going to be 1,000 square feet.
Right.
So, you know, it's a matter of the public hearing and what is the public wants to have, and the public probably needs to become more vocal to the SSRA who will run the new facility, or to the building committee, or to track members, or to the selectmen, whichever way they need to address it.
Yeah, and what Judy and I discussed was Maybe you get, at some point, if I think we understand there's a guillotine possibly out there, but then if we got rid of it altogether, but it fed food for thought, gave us food for thought, that's why we're having the meeting. But as Judy mentioned in a discussion we had, is maybe you say to the public, This is what it could be as it exists now. This would be the cost of it at 2.5 times. You give them maybe a couple options and say, what is your pleasure? What is the sense of what you want? And get some input from
my them. Sense, generally people want at least what they have.
Yes.
Currently.
That's a given. Yes.
And I think people might expect, if you're moving to a new site, it might be improved.
Yes.
The organization might be improved, the services might be improved. Mm-hmm. I think that's what people want.
Yeah, but the thing of it is, I think what we also need to do is make sure that they know the cost of that. I think what we've learned over the last couple of meetings is if you go the other way, you're going to lose the support.
Yeah.
We know that what they want exactly, and John Prati said, I think best, let's do what we're doing over there now, and then enhance it. And there's a question of how much we enhance it, how much it costs, and how much support there is for what level of enhancement.
Now, I think they decided they want to have the swap shop.
Yes.
And it's worth paying for. That's what.
Yeah, I think so. Yeah, 1,000 square feet.
Right?
Yeah.
I don't think they should revisit. I think that they should make some decisions and move on.
Okay.
Because you could spend a lifetime surveying, studying.
That's right.
And changing things. I think at some point your decisions about sort of consolidating buildings is a good decision. So that conceptually should work.
Yeah, but we also heard what Curtis said is, if it's going to require another entire staff member, then that's a concern. So
how many do you usually have on staff daily? I mean, I know you're there most of the time.
Depends on the time of day. There are 4 full-timers and 3 part-timers.
2 people always?
Not always.
And I'm looking into this, the new building, I'm assuming there's no reason to heat this. The new swap shop. Is there?
Yeah.
There is a reason to eat it.
If we consolidate it into a single building over here, we'll be, have some level heat.
Because I'm thinking where the space that you're in now, you've got the office, the big office, you've got Brian's office, you've got the swap shop, you've got the area down below.
It's heated now.
I know it's heated now, but it's all one building. And I'm looking at this and I'm seeing separate buildings. I'm seeing, I think, from what I'm reading on the thing, this looks like the office area here. And this is the swap shop over here and the recyclables and stuff like that. Well, the electronics and things go into currently a non-heated trailer. Does the oil have to be heated, the recycled, the used oil? I mean, does the swap shop have to be heated? I'm trying to think where you can save money.
I think we'll be able to accommodate some level of climate control, temperature control.
I mean, I'm just looking at this.
If you're gonna have an attendant in there, you're gonna have to have heat.
Yeah. Well, something will come through the swap shop, I'm sure, that you can use.
Yes.
I agree with Patricia. Okay, people are looking at what's been expended now for the property, what will be expended. And if there's a lessening of services, it will make a lot of people unhappy. I would like to make a motion that we recommend to SSRA and the building committee that we keep the swap shop and expand it in size to 1,000 square feet.
Is there a second to that motion?
I second.
Okay.
You have a quorum.
Oh, we don't have a quorum.
Hello. I retract my statement.
Okay, let the records show that there are that members show that the members of TRAC recommend that the swap shop be kept and expanded to 1,000 square feet. And I think that's as far as we can go. Is there any comments on that?
Well, we didn't discuss the building committee an outdoor area for outdoor materials that will be kept undercover but not inside.
Yeah.
Whether it's building materials or an old lawnmower or.
Yeah.
You said you weren't going to redo that current storage shed. Because it's too low and you're just going to not do that as part of the project?
Right.
Wouldn't that be a great place for that kind of stuff?
And it has to all be fenced in.
It has to be fenced in.
It's part of the active station.
Yeah, that's if you look at it, that's a nice place to put, if they have coal, you know, if they have a bucket, a spare bucket or even.
Equipment storage.
Yeah, any kind of storage that's dry storage. I just didn't want to include it in. I was trying to narrow the scope of what Anchor is responsible for that we can do. Like, I see that the town crew could blacktop that later on if we wanted to. But let's not get that included in the scope. Let's focus.
And you really don't have any cost estimates at this point because you don't have a plan. So you haven't really costed this out, right?
Yes.
Or do you have a square foot estimate?
We had some earlier. They went as high as 2.7 to 3 million.
But you don't have anything on the actual plan itself.
No. So we did have it on some earlier plans, but then they're so fluid now that
it's just too soon.
It's too soon to, instead of spending the money on the engineering costing, things, it really isn't worthwhile for us to spend that kind of money at this time.
It's impossible at this point because we don't know what it is even going to look like.
Yeah. They did say last meeting, it was the building committee meeting, it was suggested that maybe we use the fitting house instead of building new, and it was decided that the fitting house is a little bit too remote from the core site. And the fitting house is probably worth $300,000 in that neighborhood. And the on-site buildings at that time would be that it would replace would be 200 and some odd thousand.
So you don't think you'll sell that?
That doesn't own, we don't own that. We have to buy it.
The town does.
But you don't need it.
No, don't want it.
Right.
The printing house, Patricia, the town owns that area there.
So the town could sell it?
They're going to.
The town.
Yeah, they're considering doing some affordable housing in this area with that. I think it could be, it's renting now for a reasonable rent to someone who's workforce.
Good.
In the area.
Good.
So the land that the town owns is everything inside these, I mean, the transfer station, for the transfer station, is everything inside the dark lines?
Basically, yeah.
To the vegetation?
Yeah, basically, yes.
Okay.
It includes this.
Okay, or any other, any further?
Actually, might be a good spot for Habitat House, but.
Yeah, we've only got two in Salisbury. On Route 41 and then up on Selig Hill. We got five in Boss Village. Two in Kane.
Any public comments?
Can I ask you a question? Just that, this is just your opinion, but I'm considering that you're kind of an expert. When you go in and look at all the stuff, on average, how much of the stuff that's in our swap shop would you think is just crap that shouldn't be in there at all? I just want to know.
Wow.
Like, is it 50% on average? Is it less than 50%?
I think it's less than 50%. I mean, because I'm looking at it with a different eye.
No, I don't.
So I never had thought about it that way.
I know that some of it you don't use.
Yeah, so I'm looking at it.
I'm not considering that. I'm considering what percentage of it do you think that nobody would want it and it shouldn't have been left in there?
Well, I've talked about the Encyclopedia Britannica. You know, I mean, there are games. I've picked up games to sell that are missing pieces. They're useless. I can't
right.
sell them. So I would think they're useless to anybody else. People
puzzles
sometimes don't have a conscience.
Mm-hmm. Puzzles that are missing pieces.
Yeah, and I'm going to take
chairs.
Puzzles because I'm not going to sit and count 1,000 pieces.
Right.
Pieces of furniture that are missing pieces.
Right.
You know, I'll look at something and go, oh, that's really good. And I'll look at it again and go like, oh, well, it's broken. You know, it's like, I don't have the time or the energy to repair it.
Nobody wants a chipped coffee mug.
Exactly.
Yeah,
and so you like, throw it in the hopper. Don't bring it into the swap shop.
But you think it's under 50%?
Okay. Garbage? Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Like I said, it doesn't all necessarily appeal to me because
no,
of the reason
okay.
I'm going in, but I wouldn't say it's all garbage. I mean, people bring in lamps. Lampshades, you know, a lampshade that's damaged.
Right.
Throw it in the hopper.
Right, there's a three-piece metal torch lamp in there now. It's broken at the first joint.
You can't
Why
do
is
anything
it in there?
With it. You should go in the metal dump.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, there are things that it's like...
Yeah, once in a while there's something that I see a sign on and it's like, it's missing this and you can easily buy it. You
right,
know,
exactly.
You know, something that can be easily fixed because it has a part that you can get.
Right,
no,
and that's different. And so if people alert you to it,
right,
you know, and they just don't want it or whatever. I mean, I sometimes ask people, and they're bringing me appliances, why are you getting rid of it? Because we've gotten appliances that don't work. It's like,
and do you remember, Brian, what, I can't remember the tonnage reports, on average per month, how much we estimate?
Yeah, that's completely just a guesstimate.
Yeah,
I believe in the summertime it's 6 tons. In the wintertime it dropped down to 4.8.
This is stuff that goes in the hopper?
No,
stuff that people...
It's reused.
It's reused.
Oh.
So the tile that you took from the guy, you know, how much did that weigh? And
so,
the tire, you know, the set of tires on wheels that somebody just swapped.
So it's,
you know.
Say it's 5 tons. And I know it's not accurate, but I will say that it has been filed on the town report, signed by the selectmen, accepted by the DEP for quite a number of years. So I have to take that as the best guesstimate. So that's 5 ton a month, that's 60 ton a year, and what we're hearing is that what's left that gets thrown out is less than 50%, but even if it's 50%,
yeah, it's kind of,
that's 120 ton a year coming out of the hopper. Or actually, 60 coming out of there.
Well, but a lot of the stuff that's junk is not, there's a lot of junk that's metal, that's going in metal box.
Yeah, because I hear guys say,
it's still junk, but it's not being thrown out, it's going into the metal box to be recycled.
So we're probably 60 plus, just reasonably to assume we're 80 ton a year, and what's our all-in disposal cost? What's our tip fee?
63-ish.
How much?
63-ish.
63 plus hauling it, plus operating, well, so, 80.
Well, but you're still operating.
Yeah, you're still operating, you're right. So 80 times 80?
I don't think we have to justify.
No, but I mean, for those people who want some numbers.
Somebody's got to watch.
Maybe the 60 that you're diverting.
Yeah.
If it's going into another place, you're still trucking it.
Right, that's true.
I think basically, if you're talking about what is junk and what isn't junk, it really still comes down to Judy might not want it.
That's somebody else.
But one man's trash is another man's trash.
I'm looking at it from a different perspective.
Yeah. But there's some things that are broken and they're really useless.
Yeah. Nobody's
I think there's a little too much of that. And in the future, when we have a new transfer station, I'm hoping that we find a way to get people to use their judgment a little better. Some ways of coming up with that.
That's where a volunteer would
be.
Right,
yeah.
Right.
I mean, they already have the transfer station.
So you could be one of the volunteers.
So put it in the right place.
Well, when I go, I try to straighten everything out. But
well, and I think people that are pickers, so to speak, people that come in and pick up items and take it and sell it themselves, they're likely willing to volunteer for a couple hours on a shift because they want to have that first call on that, whatever comes in. So I think there are people out there that would take a couple hours shift. The hard part is coordinating and a coordinator.
You need somebody to
I mean, face facts, we need a coordinator.
And train them. I think Judy's right. They have to have a laminated card with the rules in their hand.
It has to be consistent.
Every time they show up, the clipboard's there, the laminated rules are there. I mean, I think you can build systems and to help train.
Definitely.
And things will probably still slip through. But for the most part, it should be approved, I think.
Right.
The difference is the existing swap shop that we have does not have the capacity to have a multi-week dwell time for items.
Yeah.
It has to come in and it has to go.
Go.
Yeah. Whether that's going out to be recycled or to be thrown out.
So a weekly cleanup.
Well, it can't even go a week in the summertime.
Won't last that long.
Look at this last 2 days.
No, we have too much.
I mean, I've got pictures from the morning to the afternoon, and you know, it's.
We generate too much good stuff.
Well, yeah. I saw a couple things in the hopper when I went home this morning. I was like,
to do it.
Oh. And I was early this morning. I was like,
yeah, no, we're
like something, little kids' rocker and something else. I don't know if they were broken or not.
We're a more affluent community, and we have a lot of material that is.
And I was just there yesterday morning, so.
Yeah.
But, you know, I mean, it happens. You can't be there 24/7, so. You don't know what's coming in. Well,
you could.
I couldn't, but but
that's what we need.
But it's a challenge. It's a game, you know. And it's and it says my mom would just laugh at me. Oh, would you?
Okay. And thank you.
Well, thank you. Nice. If anybody thinks of anything, they have any questions.
Okay.
I'm at the store 7 days a week, and or I live right around the corner. I'm 112 Thomas Moore in the phone book, 909. If you think of something tonight or tomorrow or something,
you have to stop up at your store.
I'd love you to. I'd love you to. It's, I'm very proud of it.
You should be.
Rightfully so.
We do well. We do well for having that. So. Okay.
Okay.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
I move that we adjourn.
We can't.
You can't.
We can't. Can't even do that.